So it's going to be about rough products of groups and their automorphisms. So maybe the first thing to do is to recall what the rough products are. So we've seen a few of this week already. So we define rough products of groups. So I'm going to start with gamma, a finite simplicial graph. So the node of a ledge, no loop. And for every vertex of gamma, I'm associating a group G, and sometimes called a local group. And I'm going to define a new group out of these. I'm going to define the graph product of that, which I'm just going to define, just going to denote as G of gamma. So I start from the free product of all my groups. And I'm going to add some relations. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask that the groups GV and GU are going to commute if U and V are linked by an edge in the graph. So I'm saying that G, G prime equals G prime G if G belongs to GV, G prime to GV prime, and say I've got VV prime in contained in gamma. So we've seen a few examples of graph products of groups this week. So, for instance, if I choose all my groups GV to be a copy of Z, so what I have is I start from the free product of Z, so a finite number of generators, and I'm asking that some of them commute. So what I'm getting is exactly right angle ordering groups. So if, for example, if for every V, the local group GV is dead, then what I'm getting is the right angle parking group A of gamma. If, another example we've seen, if for every vertex the local group is Z mod 2, then this time I'm getting the right angle Coxeter group, which might be another W of gamma. And whatever groups we get, we can also just like to remove assumptions on the groups, but just assumptions on the graph. So what are the extremes if gamma is discrete? So there's no edge at all in this graph. So I start from the free product, and since there's no edge, I add no further relations. What I'm gonna get is the free product of all my local groups. And at the other end, if I'm starting from the complete graph. So I start from the free product, and I ask that all the GVs commute with one another. So what I'm going to get is the direct product of my GVs. And so the graph product is a construction that's going to interpolate between those two extremes, free product and direct product. So the main question that I'm interested in today is, or the problem maybe, is understand the automorphism group of G gamma. So understand can mean many things. Can be just like compute for a start, find a generating set, or understand the geometry on what sort of spaces can this group act, etc. And we'll see both algebraic and geometric aspects of this group today. So, so what do we know? So most of the work on automorphism groups of graph products has been done for right angle ordering groups. It's much better understood. So for instance, generating set is known. Lorentz. There's nice actions on transition of outer spaces. If instead of looking at graphs, we're looking at more general graph products, then very little is known. there are some cases, for instance, if so the, there's the case of free products that's been investigated. There's been some name here. Gardell. So that's a particular case. And also, if we restrict to just finite groups, and often finite abelian groups or even finite cyclic groups, the graph product of finite, say, abelian groups. So the a few articles with lots of co-authors with interesting set of co-authors. So Charney, it's not going to be in alphabetical order. Main etc. But we see that apart, so there are two cases of groups, apart from free products, there are two cases of groups for which we know a bit about the structure and generating set or the structure of some of these subgroups. But for more general graph products, there's very little known. So the point of this talk today is to show that we can completely understand the structure of the automorphism group of some graph products of groups for arbitrary GV if instead we put some condition on the graph. So that's what I'm going to try to explain. So maybe to get started, if the first goal is to try to understand a generating set of this automorphism group, what are obvious obvious automorphisms? So, well, in every group we're going to find the inner part, so the conjugations. Since you define a graph product by a graph and a bunch of groups, so maybe I'm going to start just recall that for the case of products and explain how we generalize. So suppose for now that all my groups GD are is of set, so I've got my graph gamma. If I have a symmetry of my graph, then I can upgrade that into an automorphism of the group by just sending a generator on the, of the variables V to the generator of the image. So that's what we call the symmetric automorphisms. And coming from the automorphism group of gamma itself, there's a third class. So it's built out of a bunch of groups GV. If I start from, for each V, an automorphism of GV, I can glue them together to get an automorphism of the whole graph product. So that's what we could call local automorphisms. So we start from every V, an automorphism of GV, and you get an automorphism of the graph. And there are two other classes, so for people who are familiar with rectangle ordinary groups, so there are partial conjugations and transvections, which only exist when you have certain, for certain graphs. In particular, I'm going to be interested in cases where those more complicated ones do not appear. So that's a very nice that's a very nice class of graphs for which we only see that type of automorphisms in graphs. So it was a notion being introduced by Kasvina, Kleiner, and Sagiev in when classifying optoquasi-isometry certain right-angle ordering groups. So it's the notion of an atomic graph. So we say that gamma is atomic if there are several conditions. So we want gamma connected camera has no leak. So no vertex of elements 1. The girth of gamma is at least 5, so the smallest cycle is at least 5. And finally, we know that gamma has no separating stuff. So what does that mean?
So picture.
So I've got my graph gamma. Well, so I'm gonna choose a vertex V, and I'm gonna look at the star V, so V and all the vertices adjacent to V. So the star of V, and what I want is that for every vertex V, gamma minus the star of V is still connected. So there's no star that separates the graph into two connected components. Having separating star is exactly the condition that you need if you want to define those partial conjugations. Okay. And so what? So I was saying that this is the very nice condition so that you know that you're only going to find that type of automorphisms in your generating set, and indeed you have that. In that case, the automorphism group, so if gamma is atomic, the automorphism group of your right angle locking group is going to decompose as follows. So it's iterated semi-direct product. This part here is going to be the inner part, so the group is central S, so the inner automorphisms. That one here comes from the symmetries. So for every local group is Z, and so I can that's the local one. Sorry. Every local group is Z, so an automorphism of Z is just either I send the generator to itself or to minus itself, so I've got a coefficient of 2, and this every vertex. And finally, this one is exactly the one coming from the symmetries of the graph. Yeah. So you rule out, having atomic graphs, rule out partial conjugations and also transvections. And what I'm going to be talking about today is a generalization of this result for arbitrary graph products. So right now there's a version on the archive which is for a simpler case where gamma. I should have given an example. What's a very simple example of an atomic graph? A very good example. And actually, I'm going to focus today mostly on that case. Take gamma, a cycle on at least 5 vertices. So you can check that all the conditions are satisfied. And today I'm going to focus on this case as it's proof is simpler and it's easier to draw pictures. So I was saying, so on the archive right now there's already the version for so gamma the cycle on at least 5 vertices, and so I put it's work in progress that should be out in the fold, so for gamma atomic. So we've got the same structure for the automorphism group for arbitrary graph products, no condition whatsoever on the groups. So again, the inner part. We just need to understand what we mean by local and symmetric automorphism this time. So the this is going to generalize to just, again, I take one automorphism for each local group, so I'm going to get the product of all the automorphism group of GV. And here it's, I'm just going to write it as O of gamma G. So here I have to be a bit more careful. In the case of rags, all the local groups were the same, were all Z. So I could take any symmetry and that would give me an automorphism of the group. Here I might have different groups on different vertices. So if I want to upgrade the symmetry of the graph into an automorphism of the group, I need at least to make sure that a vertex with the group A is going to be sent to a vertex with the group isomorphic to A. So that's why I'm just going to put automorphism of gamma with some sort of like subtext here, just to mean that you need to take into account the structure of all the groups that appear in your graph. But it's a subgroup of gamma. Okay. So how are we going to do this? It's a workshop on K0 cube complexes, so there are going to be K0 cube complexes. So the goal is really to show that this automorphism group acts very nicely on a complex. It's going to be a Davis complex of the graph product for people who are familiar with that. And so maybe to give some further application, maybe the key results I'm going to detail further in the talk is that in that case, out of G gamma acts nicely on a K0 cube complex. Which allows you to get some extra properties of the automorphism group, just not the structure and the parenting set. For instance, you can use that to show that the automorphism group does not have property T because you're going to have a non-trivial action on a K0 cube complex. So that part is actually quite interesting because if you look at the spectrum of possible rags between, so for the discrete graph you're going to get Fn, for the complete graph you're going to get Zn, in between it's the general rag. So we know, for instance, that for n at least 3, GLMZ is going to have property T. This is known. For out of Fn, it's much more mysterious. So we know that there is no T for n equals 2 or 3, n is 2 to Mach 2. Recently, it was shown that it's yes, so there is T for n equals 5. That's due to Kaluba, Novak, and Kozawa. And the rest is Charlie. So well, there are cases, for instance, if the outer of the group is finite, then you know that it's going to be true. But in general, we don't know much. So even in the case, so for the case of you can construct like lots of right-angle arcing groups, not just the ones associated to atomic graphs, but if every of your local group is itself right-angle arcing group, you're going to get a new right-angle arcing group which is whose defining graph is not necessarily atomic. And for all of these, you're going to know that the automorphism group does not have a property T. But it also holds for much more general groups G. And another type of application, so we've seen a bit about hyperbolic features of groups in this workshop, so we've seen about asymmetrical hyperbolicity. And so what we've seen, so the definition of asymmetrical hyperbolicity is painful to work with because you have to deal with poles. And in many cases, in particular the case I'm going to be interested in, your space is going to be non-locally compact, and balls in non-locally compact spaces are not compact. And since you need to understand quasi-stabilizers of non-compact balls, it's a mess. There is, however, one case for which there is a much simpler criterion, which is exactly K0 cube complexes. So there's a very nice criterion that I obtained with indium metallurgy. So maybe advertise it a bit because it's very simple to use and very nice. So suppose that you have a group G that acts on a K0 cube complex. That is, okay, so there are some technical, okay, I'm just going to, okay, I want stuff to be Kaplan significable. So I want to have all the Kaprasagiev machinery on hyperplanes. I want to skewer them, I want to put them, I want to do lots of shameful things to them. I think your space needs to be irreducible. You don't want finite orbits either in the space or at infinity. What else you need? The action is essential on the hyperplanes. I think that's it. There's a bunch of conditions which are generally not too hard to check. But in that case, so there's a very simple criterion. So if you can find two hyperplanes, H1 and H2, such that the stabilizers intersect along a finite subgroup, then your group is virtually cyclic or asymmetrically hyperbolic. So you no longer have to deal with quasi-stabilizers, as in the case of asymmetricity. It's just really stabilizers and understanding how hyperplanes intersect. And actually, there's even a stronger version of the criterion. If you assume on top of that that your space X has what's called no free phase, it's a condition that essentially ensures that you can extend geodesics. So you want that every cube which is not of maximal dimension is containing at least two distinct maximal cubes. Then you can just assume that instead of having two hyperplanes, you can just assume that there is two vertices or two points. If there exists x1, x2 in x such that stabilizer of x1 intersects stabilizer of x2 along the finite subgroup, then your group is asymmetrically hyperbolic or cyclic, or virtually cyclic.
Is the hyperbolic space implicit in the statement, the contact graph, or is it something else?
Sorry?
The term asymmetrically hyperbolic presumes like a hyperbolic space, it's a nice action on it, right? Is it the contact graph, or is it some other hyperbolic space?
So what we do is we construct what's called WPD elements in Alana's talk. We really show that there is a group element that has some sort of hyperbolic axis, and the action is kind of asymmetrical along that axis. And that's enough to, and then there's the closing machinery to construct asymmetrical relations.
You don't directly see the space separation?
No.
What's the space between?
Like in the for the general criterion?
So
you're just going to look at, you're going to construct the WPD element for in X.
And
the
X is hyperbolic?
No. So you're going to construct something which is, you know, contracting as well. So.
Oh,
yeah, sorry. So, like, yeah, so the. So you use the Bezmenov-Romberg Fujiwara criterion. So if you have an element that is strongly contracting and WPD, then blah blah blah. Other questions? Okay, so that's a very nice criterion for actions on K0 cube complexes, and as we'll see, there is a very nice action in the case of of the automorphism group of those graph products. So if we just, we need one extra condition. So if we assume that for every vertex group, GV is finitely generated, and so gamma, okay, so I'm just going to put gamma is CM for now, but again, everything's, all the results that I'm going to talk about today generalize, and that's working in progress for gamma atomic. Then, the automorphism group of the graph product is, I guess it'll be pretty hyperbolic. Okay, so these were the main results, and now I'm going to try to explain a bit how you prove something like this. So understanding geometrically an automorphism group of some groups is generally not trivial. People who work on open class groups and LFN know that very well. And one of the reasons is that even if you're looking at a group itself, which is very nice, with a very nice action, there's a priori no natural action for the automorphism group itself. They are, so the ideal case, which happens in some cases, so ideally, what you would like, you've got a group G that acts nicely on a space X, so you'd like to construct an action for odd of G, and the ideal case is if the action extends, the action of G on X extends to an action of odd G on X. So for this to make sense, I'm going to assume that G is centralized. So I can see G as the subgroup of inner automorphisms of odd G. So I've got an action of that subgroup on X. I would like to extend this to an action of the whole of odd G on X. So in most cases, it's not going to work. There are some cases where it works, for instance, mapping class groups. I guess it's non-exceptional mapping class groups in general. When you look at the action of the curve complex, let's give you another example. The Hickman group, which is a very nice group, is defined by generators and relations, and has lots of exotic properties. And in particular, associated to that presentation, you can define an action on a K0-square complex. And you can show that the action of the Hickman group on this complex extends to an action of the automorphism group. And you can use this extended action to understand the automorphism group, etc. On some square complex, something I did a few years ago, and today we'll see that there's a new example that fits this very nice kind of maybe it's a rigidity of action. So there is an action of G gamma on it's called Davis complex, which I'm going to define now. And we're going to see that it extends. Okay. So maybe before talking about the Davis complex, which is going to be an example of a K0Q complex, you might wonder, well, is there like even a simpler action like action on trees, so it's like splittings, for instance? And they are. For graphs that are not joins, you can decompose your graph product G of gamma as an amalgamated product. We have an action on the Bastard tree, but there's no chance that this is going to give you something that you can extend to the automorphism group itself, because to define this splitting, you've chosen the vertex. In doing that, you're kind of preventing this fact becomes no longer invariant. You're not going to be able to do that. So to hope to get something which is invariant in your automorphisms, you need to, in a sense, avoid choices. And the database complex is an example of an action where essentially all the local groups play the same role. So I'm going to define it now. Okay, so I'm going to define the database complex by first defining the vertices, then the edges, then the higher synthesis, etc. So the vertices are going to be in correspondence with cosets of the form G times the subgroup generated by a subgraph gamma, where gamma prime is a subgraph of gamma, which is a clique. So maybe, since I'm going to start drawing pictures from now on, I'm going to suppose that I'm in the case of a cycle. So if you look at the case of a cycle, for instance, here, so the possible cliques so there are three types. So there's the empty subgraph, which we will want to consider as a subgraph. There is the vertex, single vertex, an example of a clique, and finally there's a case of an edge, which is a complete subgraph on two vertices, and there's no triangle in a cycle on at least five vertices, so these are all my cliques. Okay, so these are the vertices of the database complex. Now about the edges. So I'm going to put an edge between two cosets of the form G gamma prime and G gamma prime, double prime, for the same G, if, for instance, I'm going to assume that gamma is contained in gamma double prime, and they only differ by one vertex. So gamma prime minus gamma double prime minus gamma has cardinality 1. Okay, so now I've defined vertices, I've defined edges, so I already have a superficial graph. And now what I'm going to do to define a cube complex, I'm just going to fill the cubes. So I'm going to take, in a sense, the cubical flight complex. So whenever I see the four cycles of the boundary of a square, I'm going to add that square. And that for all of them, that's going to give me a two-dimensional complex. Now if I see the boundary of a three cube, so a bunch of squares together, I'm going to add this three cube, and I do that for all of them. It's going to give me something three-dimensional, and I keep going. And because I've got a finite graph to start with, this process is going to terminate eventually. I'm going to end up with a complex which is made of cubes. So that's called the Davis complex. And so the one very nice property of this complex is that it is a class zero cube complex. Actually more than that, it's actually also a right angle building. But we're not going to use the building structure in this one. The casual cubical aspects are going to be enough for everything we want to do. Okay, so maybe a picture. These cosets are not really easy to see. So let's draw one simple example. So I'm going to take the simplest example I can draw. So a pentagon. A simple example of graph product. I'm going to do the right angle Costner group on the pentagon. So what do we get for that? So the Davis complex is going to be, so I'm just going to draw it and explain where it comes from. So what I'm going to get is the hyperbolic plane tiled by right-angled pentagons. Okay. So you've got a bunch of pentagons, four around each vertex and two at each edge. So I need to have a Catherine cube complex. So what I'm going to look at is actually the cubical subdivision of this type. So I put an extra vertex. So I'm going to just call it for that because I don't want to remove them in a bit. So I'm going to add a vertex in the center of each pentagon, a vertex at the center of each edge, and add the missing edges. So one edge here, etc. So each pentagon is subdivided into five squares, and now what I see here, and you can check the link condition, what I see here is a cat zero square complex. Cat zero square complex. So that's the Davis complex. But actually, so from now on, just for to make it simpler.
Can you say what about the inspiration of the idea behind Davis complex? Why this?
Why?
Well,
in the case, if all your, you know, if, so for Coxeter groups, you get essentially the Davis complex. If you derive it, instead of taking the subgraph gamma prime, which are cliques, you just want the subgraph gamma prime such that the induced Coxeter group is finite. And what you get in that case is, again, it's what's called the Davis complex in that case. It's a very nice model with the classifying space for population. It is a very natural complex. It turns out that the fact that you took, you know, like finite stabilizer is not really relevant. You're still going to get the Cat0 cube complex for general graph products. It's just that the action is no longer proper. It's still co-compact, and you're still a very nice geometry on the complex itself. And that's this geometry that we want to use for
using.
Yeah, it's probably quasi-isometric to electrify those clique subgroups, yeah, those maximal products. You probably get the same thing with like what happened to the magnetic class group. Yeah. Are there other questions about this? Okay, so just for the rest of the talk, for simplicity, instead of when I be talking about the Davis complex, I'm going to forget about the cubical structure here. I'm just going to focus on the underlying polygonal complex. So what I'm going to do is I forget all these red edges. It's going to be much cleaner to define everything I want to define. So recall what we want to do. So here we've got a very nice action of the graph product on this space. So my vertices are cosets, so I'm just going to add back by left multiplication on the left. I've got an action of G gamma. What I would like is to show that I can define an action of opt of G gamma on this. So one way to start thinking about how we're going to do that is to realize that there is a bijection between the vertices. So the vertices which you should think of as sort of cosets, and the stabilizers of vertices, which are the conjugate. And the reason for that is that the vertices here, the stabilizers of vertices, it's going to be up to conjugation something of the form gi cross gi plus 1. So in my cycle, I take two consecutive groups, and I take their direct product. And those subgroups are self-normalizing. So it's just because of that, I'm going to have a bijection between the vertices and the collection of the cosets and the collection of the conjugates. And now it's much more natural to think in terms of stabilizer, because now I've got subgroups. So what I would like to is to show that an automorphism of G gamma is going to preserve this collection of subgroups. It's going to send a vertex to a vertex, an edge to an edge, etc. So what I need is to characterize this family of subgroups in a way that is invariant under automorphisms. Try to characterize what it means to be an edge, what it means to be a polygon, and all that. And that's when we stop, 10 minutes, right? Okay, so I'm just gonna give the main idea for that. And for that, I'm gonna introduce some subcomplex. It was introduced by Goldman. Technically, at least, I think in one article, I saw them called tree walls. And the reason I'm going to swap that is that, as the name implies, they are trees. But the name does not imply that they are not walls in the sense of quasi-real field complexity. So they are trees, so I'm just going to call them wall trees. So a wall tree is going to be a maximal subgraph of the, oh, I didn't give it a name, the Davis complex. Let's call it X. A maximal subgraph of the Davis complex of the one skeleton, such that maximal connected subgraph, such that the angle between two consecutive edges is. So the angles can be, in that case, either pi or pi over 2, because since I've got direct products, I'm going to get the length of a vertex is going to be a join of two discrete sets. And so the picture, which is very easy to draw in that case, in the case of the hyperbolic plane tiled by right angle pentagons, I'm going to get those line geodesic lines like that. So this is an example of a wall tree. This is another example of the wall tree, maybe one last one. So third example, etc. And if for a much more general graph product, so you're going to get a Davis complex, which is a building. So if you still take a pentagon, you're going to get a Davis complex, which is going to be a building whose apartments are exactly that. So what you're going to get is wall trees built out of those lines, using the gluing between the apartments. Right, and the key the key fact is that the stabilizer of a wall tree is something, so it's the subgroup generated by three adjacent vertices, so that's actually, you can write that as, since that commute with those two is going to be a direct product gi cross and the free product of the other two. And that's what's really important here is that now this is, you can show using the result of Minassian and Ozin that this family of subgroups of my graph products are exactly the maximal products. Non-trivial products. So here, everything I'm doing here is in the case of a cycle. So that's the.
Can you say quickly what the sort of analogous statement is in more generally for the stabilizer?
Well, then, the stabilizer of a wall tree is going to be. That's going to generalize to the stabilizer, so that's going to be the subgroup generated by a star, which is also going to be the maximal product. And so now this is a much nicer characterization because the maximal product is a family of subgroups which is invariant under automorphisms. So now this is invariant under bond. Okay, so I've characterized, so I know already that my automorphism group acts on the family of stabilizers of all trees, but what I wanted was, you know, I've done vertices and edges and all that, so I'm halfway there.
Can you do a sort of, have you, maybe you made it already, I didn't notice, did you make a non-triviality assumption on what we would
do? Oh yeah, no, I forgot to, yes, we need, yeah, you need, yes.
Is that it, they just need to be non-trivial?
They just need to be non-trivial, and, yes. Yes, you're right, but otherwise you've got, like, you're, like, for instance, you're going to have three phase if you're, but it is, yeah. Yeah, thanks for that. Right, so now I want to go from stabilizer of wall tree to the stabilizer, understanding why I'm going to stabilize, stabilize the family of stabilizers of vertices. Okay, so the naive idea, well, it's going to work eventually, but is to say, well, okay, I've got a vertex, my div is complex, that vertex is the intersection of two wall trees. So I want to essentially encode a vertex as being the intersection of two wall trees. I would like to say, well, the family of stabilizers of vertices is exactly the family of the intersection of two wall trees, which is almost true. You can have, you need to be a bit careful, because when I say it's the intersection of two wall trees, I'm assuming that those two wall trees intersect. But I could be looking at a wall tree like that. And since I need to look at everything algebraically, I'm not allowed to use geometry if I want to have a construction which is invariant under automorphisms, I need to tell apart two intersecting wall trees from two non-intersecting wall trees if I want to characterize the stabilizers of vertices. And it is possible, and the way to do that is to, since I'm almost out of time, I'm just gonna give the gist of it. So you're gonna look at the action of G gamma on the intersection graph of wall trees. So vertices correspond to wall trees, edge correspond to intersection. So you can also think of that, if you go back to the cubical structure of the Davis complex, this is the crossing graph of the complex. So a wall tree is exactly a parallelism class of a hyperplane, and the two wall trees intersect exactly when the corresponding hyperplanes intersect, I mean cross. So it's really the crossing graph, not just the contact graph. They're quasi-isometric because lanes have a uniformly bounded diameter. What you can show is that this action has a weak form of cylindricity, and in particular, so I'm just going to write it. If you have two trees at distance exactly once, if they cross, we're going to get that their stabilizer intersect exactly along something of the form gi plus 1. If they are at distance 2, so that's the case here, for instance, green and red, they're at distance 2 because they're, those two are at distance 1, those two are at distance 1, but those two do not cross. So in that case, the stabilizer of the wall trees intersect along something of the form just one little group. And finally, if the distance is at least 3, you get that the intersection is trivial. So you've got something similar to what happens in the weak cylindricity of the mapping class group acting on the curve complex. If you have two curves at distance at least 3, they fill the surface, so the intersection of the stabilizer is going to be finite. It's kind of an analogous statement. In particular, we see now that we can characterize those wall trees that intersect by looking at the way, really the structure of those intersections. And here again, you use the fact that the call the GI is a wall tree. So that's really important. And so in particular, you can show that the stabilizer of a vertex, the family of all stabilizers of vertices, is going to be preserved by an automorphism. So now you know already that the automorphism group of G gamma acts on the vertex set of the Davis complex. Now you need to characterize edges. So again, you're not allowed to use geometry. So you know that if two vertices are joined by an edge, the stabilizers intersect along something which is isomorphic to some GI. But that's actually true for any pair of vertices on the same whole tree. So you need to tell them apart. So you can do some extra work, and the idea is to be look at the subgroup that those two vertex groups are going to generate. You can really characterize edges like that. And then you have to characterize the polygons. And once you have this, you can produce all those nice properties. And the same kind of strategy is going to work more generally in the atomic case, but in that case, there is complex. The main cell is not going to be a pentagon, it's going to be essentially the cone on the graph. So it's a bit more complicated because you're not just having like one fundamental domain being one single polygon, you're going to have lots of polygons. You need to understand how they interact. You need to understand geometrically how to prevent partial conjugation. So there's a bit more work, but eventually it's going to hold. So I'm going to stop here. Thank you. It's really hard to even see how to extend if you just don't look at atomic graphs, but if you just restrict, like, just take the graphs with girth at least 5, I would expect also, I guess, not T, because you're going to have some sort of, like, locally finite small concentration geometry appearing. But, yeah, it's hard, apart from that, it's hard to guess. I'm not even sure that, you know, the natural guess is to expect that, like for GL and Z, auto FN is going to have T for N large enough, but even that is going to get one result right now. So it's true for N equals 5. So.
Maybe let's take a speaker again.